a song? Joshua, I need you to bring Gerbert up here. How many of you ever heard of Gerbert? Have you heard Gerbert sing? Did you know Gerbert can sing? Is that the wrong way? Have you ever heard Gerbert sing? Gerbert is...
Let me have Gerbert sing. Come on up.
Come on.
Okay.
You're going to sing with me. Come on. Let me have Gerbert sing. Come on. Somebody's getting tired this weekend.
Tired.
So I'll stay outside.
This is Gerbert. Now, Mark calls it Pumpkinhead. Okay. But Gerbert is a Christian puppet, and Gerbert has sang with Sandy Patty before. He has a program on CBN.
What?
CBN, right?
Uh-huh.
Good. Sure. She's got it. CBN, and Gerbert's a Christian puppet, and what he does is he teaches the kids a lot of things about when they're having a bad day and stuff like that, and but how much God plays an important role in our lives. And Joshua and I wanted to sing a song with you, and Gerbert's going to sing it with us. Isn't he? Huh? Is he going to sing it with us? Let's try it. We'll see. It's the plug.
It must be the plug.
Today.
There's some plugs down there.
Yeah,
there's one over there.
My wall is small.
There's one that wire around.
Yeah. I think we turned the switch off on it earlier. Nope.
No.
It's the plug. Just a second.
Evan, isn't there one right there near y'all?
There's one right over here. Here we go. Come on, Josh.
Jesus and me. Jesus and me.
really just the chorus of Victory in Jesus, okay?
Special requests that you'd like to share for personal nature or needs that you know of that you'd like us to pray for this morning?
We have several people, young people in our midst, who are very undecided about their future and they're not sure what the Lord is leading them to do. And we need to pray for them that God will give them guidance and help them with their lives, give them the right direction.
Good. Is there other? Other special needs, Lynn?
Jan got real sick last night and waiting for her to have strength to make a long trip back home.
Mm-hmm. All right. The Bible tells us, bear you one another's burdens. And that's what we want to do as a family together.
We would appreciate your prayers as we get our new assignment tomorrow.
All right. Okay, let's remember Helen and Robin going up to pastor the Emmanuel Church.
Let's pray for all the
all right, guys. All the names work. Let's do remember him.
Pray for my mother's.
Your mom. All right.
What?
Any other need? Any other request?
Of course, I would look your hands off Scott because we tell you guys over here. In Lima, there was a 17-year-old boy who broke his neck in 3 places swimming. He's in Jacksonville, been there since Father's Day. They can't operate. He had an infection, and his temperature has been too high to operate since he's been to the hospital. So even if he does live, he'll be paralyzed from his chest down. And for a 17-year-old, that's, and for his family, it's just a very difficult time. We're just praying that God will work.
Our Father, we are worshiping the great big God. When you look down, we've heard so many requests made already. You know exactly what the need is. This young person that has broken neck, we know that you can help him. And Lord, we pray that you'll touch him and touch his life. And then all of these young people, Lord, that prayer was requested for their so they'll know what path to take out here in the future. We realize that what we do matters to God. Where we go matters to God. So we pray that you would help me, Lord, our young people. Now, Lord, this young mother that has cancer, you know what? We know that you are the great physician, and we've been to you before. We thank you, Lord. We go to you again and again. Our needs. And we pray that you would somehow, Lord, touch this mother. And if you can see fit, totally heal her so she can be with her family and raise the children like they should go. And Father, we pray for Harley this morning. said, keep us, keep in your prayers down while you're down on the coast. That's what we've done. And we pray that you'd come from his heart this morning. Help him, Lord, that he can be all that you want him to be. And the days that he has left, we pray that you'll make him sweet and good to him. There's all been names worth, Lord. We know him personally. We pray that you'll help him. You know what his need is, and we know that God is a God that's able to do exceeding abundant above all we can ask or think. We realize that we've never served you in vain because we've asked and you've given. We've knocked and you've opened doors that we thought couldn't be opened. We appreciate it this morning, Lord. And as we've all gathered here for this final service of the reunion, we pray that you'll bless our hearts together and give us traveling safety on the road as we go back. Thank you for the traveling mercies you've given over the miles coming here. And we pray that as we leave, you'll do the same. There are other requests, Lord, that have been mentioned. Be with Alan and Robbins that go to the new assignment. Bless them, Lord. Bless the minister there. May it be fruitful. May God, may God's Spirit be upon them every day of that they spend there as pastors. And Lord, for these other requests that don't come to our mind right now, you heard them. And God knows everything. You know exactly what to do. You know what to how to answer the request of every one. Now, Lord, keep us all up close to you. Thank you for the good time and fellowship we had together down here during these few days. And may we be faithful until that great reunion will be on us. Oh, we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen.
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 It's been a good time together.
Amen.
That's
right.
Down here. And I think Jenny has really enjoyed it. Yeah. I've watched her around here from time to time. So good to have the Quilkerson again with us in this family reunion. Sure good to have had James Ogden and his wife with us during this time too.
Right.
Oh, we just feel like just a big family all together, and we are. And that's what God wants us to be. I was in revival meeting over in Meridian about 5 years ago now, and Claudine attended some of the services in the revival, and one night I preached from the 17th chapter of the Gospel of St. John. About 2 years ago down here at the family reunion, she said, why don't you share that 17th chapter of John with us? And I have decided that this morning, that's what I want us to look into, the 17th chapter of John. And if you have your Bible and want to look into it with us as we read the scripture this morning, I'm going to read this chapter. You know, in the Old Testament, in the worship, there was the tabernacle, a little later the temple. There was what was known as the holy place where the priests ministered every day, but then there was the Holy of Holies that he went into one time out of the year, the high priest did. A very, very holy place. And when I think of the 17th chapter of John and of all of the scriptures, to me, this chapter is just about the Holy of Holies. Because it's the final conclusion of the ministry of Jesus. As he's now completed his ministry, and he is praying the final prayer with his disciples before his crucifixion. And as he's praying this prayer for them and for all disciples down through the ages of time, down to where we are and beyond us, because this chapter includes us as Christians today. And I want us to look at this chapter in these moments that we have together. And I don't know of anything that's more important than the Word of God as we meet together. For after all, it doesn't matter too much what man may say, but it all matters all completely what God says and His Word. So here is the prayer that Jesus prayed. These words spake Jesus and lifted up his eyes to heaven and said, Father, the hour is come. Glorify thy Son, that thy Son also may glorify thee. As thou hast given him power over all flesh, that he should give eternal life to as many as thou hast given him. And this is life eternal, that they might know thee, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom thou hast sent. I have glorified thee on the earth. I have finished the work which thou gavest me to do. And thou, O Father, glorify thou me with thine own self, with the glory which I had with thee before the world was. I have manifested thy name unto the men which thou gavest me out of the world. Thine they were, and thou gavest them me, and they have kept thy word. Now they have known that all things whatsoever I have given thee are of thee. For I have given unto them thy word which thou gavest me, and they have received them and have known surely that I came out from thee, and they have believed that thou didst send me. I pray for them. I pray not for the world, but for them which thou hast given me, for they are thine, and all mine are thine, and thine are mine, and I am glorified in them. And now I am no more in the world, but these are in the world, and I come to thee. Holy Father, keep through thine own name those thou hast given me, that they may be one as we are. While I was with them in the world, I kept them in thy name. Those that thou gavest me, I have kept, and none of them is lost, but the son of perdition, that the scriptures might be fulfilled. And now come I to thee, and these things speak I in the world, that they might have my joy fulfilled in themselves. I have given them thy word, and the world hath hated them, because they are not of the world, even as I am not of the world. I pray not that thou shouldst take them out of the world, but that thou shouldst keep them from the evil. They are not of the world, even as I am not of the world. Sanctify them through thy truth. Thy word is truth. As thou hast sent me into the world, even so have I also sent them into the world. And for their sakes I sanctify myself, that they also might be sanctified through the truth. Neither pray I for these alone, but for them also which shall believe on me through their word, that they all may be one, as thou, Father, art in me, and I in thee, that they also may be one in us, that the world may believe that thou hast sent me. And the glory which thou gavest me I have given them, that they all may be one, even as we are one. I in them, and thou in me, that they may be made perfect in one, and that the world may know that thou hast sent me, and hast loved them as thou hast loved me. Father, I will that they also whom thou hast given me be with me where I am, that they may behold my glory which thou hast given me, for thou lovest me before the foundation of the world. O righteous Father, the world hath not known thee, but I have known thee, and these have known that thou hast sent me. And I have declared unto them thy name, and will declare it, that the love wherewith thou hast loved me may be in them, and I in them. This is the greatest prayer that has ever been prayed. It was prayed by the greatest prayer to ever pray. And in this prayer, as Jesus has prayed it, actually it's divided into three different divisions. Verses 1 through 5, he was praying for and about himself primarily. Verses 6 through 19, he was praying primarily for the immediate disciples which were with him at that particular time. And then verses 20 through 26, he's praying for all disciples of all ages down to where we are, so that he included you and me in this prayer just as much as he included the disciples that were with him. For you notice he said, neither pray I for these alone, but for them which shall believe on me through their word. And in this prayer that Jesus is praying, actually is expressed at least four great desires in it. First of all, that, for he mentions this fact in verse 5, where he said, and now, O Father, glorify thou me with the glory which I had with thee before the world was. And the one thing that he endeavored to do while he was, and did do while he was here in this earth, was to glorify the Father. And that's what the Bible tells us that we're to do. For the Bible tells us in the book of Colossians and in the book of Corinthians, whatsoever you do in word or deed, do all to the glory of God. And if we're living below that level, we're living on a level that God doesn't want us to live on. He wants us to move to the higher level, so that everything that we do will bring glory and honor unto the Father. And the second thing that he was praying about here in relationship to himself, actually two of these requests were in relationship to himself, and two was in relationship to his disciples. And this second one in relationship to himself is this, that the Father might restore unto him the glory that he had with him before the world back there. He laid that aside when he came into this world to become man, to go to the cross and to die for our sin. And now that he's saying unto the Father, restore unto me the glory which I had with you before the world was. And this part of the prayer has been answered, because the Bible tells us that God has exalted him, given him a name that's above all names, that at the name of Jesus every knee shall bow and every tongue confess of things in heaven and things in earth. Two great requests that he had in relationship to his disciples. Then the first one was this, that they all might be sanctified, because he said, sanctify them through thy truth. Thy word is truth. And this prayer is still in effect for today. But then the other request that he had in relationship to his disciples, that all of his disciples and all believers might one day be with him. For he said, Father, I will that they whom you've given me be with me where I am, that they may behold my glory. So with these desires that he expressed in this, I want us to look at the first of those desires, where his desire is that all of his disciples, all Christians, be sanctified. And he gives six different reasons in this chapter why he wants all disciples, all Christians, to be sanctified. Number one, he wants us all to be sanctified for purification, or to purify us. That word sanctify, if you'll go back and look at it, you'll find that it has two meanings. The first of those meanings is to set apart or to dedicate for a holy purpose. The other meaning of it is to purify, to cleanse from all sin, to make holy. And in this, it deals with God's part of the sanctification and our part. It's our part to dedicate and to consecrate ourselves to God for His purposes, for His will. It's God's part to do the cleansing, the purifying, the making holy. And here he's saying, Father, I want my disciples to be pure. And he still wants that. And I'm glad that in the midst of an impure, unholy, ungodly world, we can live a pure, godly, holy life day by day. Jesus knew that these disciples needed this, because he saw in them this selfishness, this place-seeking that they had in their life, and he knew it would not do to send them out into the world with that kind of an attitude. So he's saying, Father, I want you to purify them, cleanse them, so that they can be pure and can be holy in my sight. But the second reason that he mentions in this that he wants all of his disciples to be sanctified is for unification. Purification and then unification. Because did you notice what he said? That they all may be made perfect in one. And then he went on to say that they might be one with each other. For he said that they all may be one as thou art in me, as we're one. He said, I want them to be one. So he's saying, I want unification. I want my disciples to be one in spirit, in motive, in desire, in purpose in their life. And I know we have, right here we have different denominations represented. We have lots of denominations of the world represented. But God wants his people to be one wherever they are. And I can have wonderful fellowship with a real Christian. I don't care what their denomination is. I remember while pastoring over in Baton Rouge, I went to a nursing home there about every Monday and had a service. And I told those folks in the nursing home many times, I said, I'm not interested in what denomination you are, what church you may have attended. The thing I'm interested in, do you know Christ? Do you know him as Lord and as Savior of your life? And that's the way it is with Jesus here. He's saying, Father, sanctify them that they may be one, that there may be this unification, one with each other. And God will make us that way when our hearts are clean and pure through the blessed Holy Spirit. Oh, I heard years ago about the husband and the wife that didn't get along too good. They didn't communicate too much. And one day they were riding in a wagon late in the afternoon going down the road. And two horses pulling the wagon. And as they were going along, the wife got to noticing that the horses were in perfect step and called the husband's attention to it. Said, look there at those horses. They're in perfect step. Wouldn't it be wonderful if we had that kind of harmony in our home? He said, oh, we would have if there wasn't one tongue between them like there is then. But it isn't a matter of the one tongue, it's the one heart. Because the Bible says from the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. So here he's saying, I want them sanctified for unification. Not just one with each other, but one with God. Because he went on to say, as thou, Father, art in me and I in thee, that they also may be one in us. To where we'll be one with God, to where we want nothing but what God wants. Where we want his will, his plans, his desires, and all of this. And every one of us has to lay aside our desires, our will, our plan, and take God's will and God's plan. Because if we try to hold on to our plan and our desires and hold on to God's plan and God's desires, there's going to be the conflict there. But he's saying, I want them to be one with us in this. You say, did the disciples ever reach a place like that? Yes, in the book of Acts, the 4th chapter, and the 32nd verse, it said, and the multitude of them that believed were of one heart and of one soul. The multitude of them, they became one in the Lord. But another reason he wants us to be sanctified is for satisfaction. He wants us to be satisfied. And in this he speaks of a perfect joy. And he said, and now come I to thee, and these things speak I in the world, that they might have my joy fulfilled in themselves. Here's satisfaction. Total satisfaction. The joy of the Lord within us. But in connection with that joy too is also the matter of the perfect love. This perfect love that casts out fear. And in that last verse he mentioned this fact about the perfect love, that the love wherewith you have loved me may be in them and I in them. And that love that God had for his son was a perfect love. And he's saying, Father, I want that same love in them. Day by day. So there's perfect satisfaction, the perfect joy of God, the perfect love of God within the heart. But then the next reason he wants us to be sanctified is for evangelization, that we might be evangelists. You say, oh, I'm not an evangelist. Yeah, we're Christians, we are. Every one of us, we are. I attended a seminar out in Oklahoma City a few years ago. And I remember the leader of that seminar said, I'd like to have every minister in the congregation to stand. And a few stood. He said, no, I won't ever minister in the congregation to stand. And a few more stood. And he said, no, you misunderstand me. I said, I won't ever minister in the congregation to stand. And then he said, if you're a Christian, you're a minister. You're a minister for Jesus Christ. We're a representative of Jesus Christ. And here Jesus is telling his disciples, he said, I want you to be sanctified for evangelization. I want you to be an evangelist for me. And every Christian is to be an evangelist for him. Because you notice what he said in it. He said, Father, as you have sent me into the world, even so I'm sending them into the world. Why did Jesus come? He came as an evangelist. He came to die for our sin. He came for the salvation of the world. He's saying to every one of us as Christians, he's saying, and that's the reason I'm sending you into the world. Two other verses in relationship to that, where he said that they all may be one in us, that the world may believe that you have sent me. You notice he said back here, I pray for them, I pray not for the world. But now then he's saying, Father, sanctify them so that the world may believe. Use them as an evangelist. And then another verse there where he mentioned this fact, I in them and thou in me, that they may be made perfect in one, and that the world may know that you have sent me and have loved them as you have loved me. You notice he mentioned the world there. So he's saying to those disciples, I'm sending you out to the world. And that's what he's saying to his disciples today. I want you to be sanctified to be evangelists for me. I'm sending you into the world. And it isn't always talk that gets the job done. It's the life that's lived. An atheist in a community one day came to a preacher and said to that preacher, Preacher, I can answer all of your arguments and everything about the Bible, but he said there's a lady that's a member of your church that lives across the road from me down where I live. I don't have any answer for the life that she lives. He said, there's something different there. That's what Christ is talking about right here. He's saying, I want them to so live, so act, so speak, so do, that the world may believe in me. Dr. A.J. Gordon, great minister in a big church up in Boston, Massachusetts years ago, said that the greatest compliment anybody ever paid to him was a little boy one day when he was walking down the street. He came up to him and looked up into his face and said, Mister, are you Jesus? He said, I was glad that boy could see something of Jesus Christ in my life. And that's what Jesus is saying right here. He's saying, Father, I want them to be filled with your Spirit so that the world can see me in their lives. Well, the next reason he wants us to be sanctified is for preservation. To preserve us, to keep us. You notice he had said, Holy Father, keep through thine own name those that you've given me. And then he went on to say, while I was with them in the world, I kept them in thy name. Those that you've given me, I have kept, and none of them is lost but the son of perdition. But then he went on to say, also, I pray not that you should take them out of the world, but that you should keep them from the evil of the world. Here is preservation. So he's saying, Father, fill them with your Spirit so that they can be kept. He said, I kept them while I was with them. But now it's going to have to be the Holy Spirit keeping them on the inside, day by day. Preservation, keeping. A little instrument on the wall right over here is very important. We call it a thermostat. But you know, it governs the temperature in this building. No matter what it is out there, it governs the temperature in here. And that's what God is saying. I want my Holy Spirit living in the lives of my disciples so that no matter what's on the outside out there, I can keep them on the inside day by day. My good bud Robinson, they tell us that on one occasion, was in some revival services up in around the state of New York and close to the city of New York. Someone came to him one day and said to him, hey, we'd like to take you down through the city and show you the sights of the great city. So he spent most of the day with them, going through the city and seeing the various sights. Came in late in the afternoon and said Uncle Bud was tired and weary. Said he got down on his knees and said, now, Lord, I want to thank you that I haven't seen a thing today that I want. Why? He was satisfied. He was kept on the inside. You know, this takes care of a whole lot of the wants of people. Where we're filled with His Spirit, living the way He wants us to live day by day, He keeps us, He preserves us, moment by moment. But the final thing that He tells us, and He's talking to His Heavenly Father here in this prayer, and you know, when any person is truly praying, they're expressing the desire of the heart. They're really telling what they want and what they need and the real feelings of the heart. And so Jesus is telling His Heavenly Father this, what He's wanting Him to do. But the final thing is this. He is saying, Father, I want them to be sanctified for preparation, to prepare them. For He said, I will that they whom you have given unto me, that they be with me where I am, that they may behold my glory. So He's saying, Father, sanctify them to prepare them for this. And actually, it brings a threefold preparation. There's a preparation for life, a preparation for death, and a preparation for eternity. And it's all right here in this. Remember, Jesus told His disciples, don't depart from Jerusalem, but wait for the promise of the Father. For He said, you shall receive power after that the Holy Spirit has come upon you. Then you'll be witnesses unto me in Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, to the uttermost parts of the earth. This is preparation for life. And God has a preparation for life for us as individuals, where we can really be prepared for life. And we're not fully prepared for life until the Holy Spirit has complete control of our lives, day by day. Then He prepares us for life, but then He prepares us for death. It's the great preparation for death. Because you see, the thing that prepares us for life also prepares us for death, where we can be ready at that time. John Wesley, talking about the early Methodists, said, best of all, our people die well. And that's the secret, and that's the thing that we want, is to be able to die well. But I'm glad God has a grace that He can put in us day by day to help us to live victorious so that we can die victorious. But it's also the preparation for eternity. To be with God, with Christ, forever and forever. Back in chapter 14 of this same book, Jesus had said to His disciples, I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare this place for you, I'll come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there you may be also. Now then, in this 17th chapter, He's praying and saying, Father, prepare them for that place. Get them ready for that place. And that's the heart of His prayer. I remember February the 19th, 1947, at about 25 minutes to 1 o'clock, in the college chapel up at college in Nashville, Tennessee. I remember the Lord sanctified me there that day. Oh, I was down there for about an hour praying. I didn't know what to do. I could have got through a lot quicker if I had just known more about what to do. But I remember Brother D.H. Spencer, who was the Dean of Men at the college at that time, he was kneeling across the altar from me and he was praying, and he spent quite a few years as a missionary in Africa after that. He said to me, Ford, have you done everything you can do to be sanctified? And I couldn't think of a thing else. I knew what God wanted me to do. I knew God wanted me to preach. And I was willing to do it. I was willing to do what I knew He wanted me to do. And I said, yes, I've done all I can do. Everything I know. He said, then are you willing to let God do the rest? And I said, yes, I will. I'm willing right now. And I let God through the Holy Spirit come and do it in my life. You know, I'd seen some people when they prayed through like that, they just shouted all over the place. And I had the idea, well, I'll have to do that too. But I didn't shout a lick. I didn't shout a bit when that happened. But I tell you the thing that did happen, the most wonderful peace that I'd ever known just quietly went through my total being. It just felt like I'd been had a bath on the inside, and everything was clean. It was about a week or two after that that I was walking across the college campus on my way to class one day, and as I was walking along, I began to think about what God had done. And it dawned on me all of a sudden, I'm ready to live. He's prepared me for life. And if I drop dead right here, I'm prepared for death. I'm prepared for eternity. And I tell you, I about had a spell out on the campus when I realized what God had done within my life. Preparation. So for those reasons, he wants us to be sanctified for purification, for unification, for perfect satisfaction, for evangelization, for preservation, and for preparation. Praise the Lord. I'm glad that it's so for today. I want us to bow our heads, and I'm going to ask Adam to be concluding in the service this morning and praying and pronouncing the benediction. We want God to have his way in our lives as we go from here today, that we may have the presence of his Spirit going with us in everything. You know, as we meet together in these family gatherings, I would not be surprised but what many times there are some spiritual needs in the lives of some. I don't know what the needs are. The blessed Holy Spirit does. And he's the one that can show us, and only he can show us and help us to see needs that we may have in our life. But it's wonderful to know that in a setting like this, that is, we pray, just whisper the prayer from the depths of the heart, and God can meet the need and answer prayers right where we are. We're living, I believe, in the very, very last days, right up to the coming of Jesus Christ back to this earth again. There's never been a time like the times we're living. And the seeing of the things fulfilled according to the Bible. And every one of us had better be very, very, very careful that we keep up to date, day by day, to be ready to meet Jesus at any time. And that's what we want to do. So I'm going to ask Adam to pray for us here in the conclusion of this morning.
Our Father and our God, thank you for making it possible. We thank you for Jesus.
Amen.
Who did lay aside his glory.
Yes.
we might just sing the verse of it, and then the chorus. I think we possibly would know it, wouldn't we? If we get some words mixed up, we'll just put some in and go on. Sing.
God be with you till we meet again. By his counsels guide, uphold you. With his strength securely fold you. God be with you till we meet again. Anything else before we go? Well, praise the Lord for a wonderful time together. Amen.
Well, Carly.